Good evening to everyone. Venerable members of the Mahasangha, my dear colleagues and fellow academics, I warmly welcome all of you to this event. As the head of the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies, University of Calcutta. As you know, last month we successfully completed this lecture series in Sinhala media. And again now, we are very happy that we have been able to call this lecture series in English medium, following the request made by you in the previous lecture series. I don't plan to deliver a long speech. I would like to express my gratitude to Emeritus Senior Professor Sumanapala Galmangoda for accepting our invitation to conduct this lecture series. He has done a vast contribution for the academic development of our university as a lecturer, senior lecturer, professor, senior professor, head of the department, distinguished researcher, and as a director in some institutes affiliated to the university. And also he has introduced various new dimensions to enrich the field of Buddhist studies in Sri Lanka. I would like to mention that Professor Sumanapala is the first and the only professor who did a great contribution to introduce Buddhist psychology and counseling as a subject to universities in Sri Lanka. Since this lecture series is very important and historical, we, as the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies, consolidated all our efforts to organize this event. Therefore, I would like to thank Emeritus Senior Professor Sumanapala Galmangoda on behalf of the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies for undertaking to conduct this lecture series. Next, I would like to express my gratitude to our Vice Chancellor, Senior Professor Nilanth De Silva, for encouraging us to accomplish this kind of academic activities. Then I would like to thank the organizers of the program, Senior Lecturer Amila Kaluarachchi and Lecturer Venerable Valasmulle Baddiya for their dedication to make this event a success. And also I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Senior Lecturer Venerable Dinyaye Panyaloka for functioning as the master of ceremony at this event. Especially, I would like to give my heartiest thanks to Lecturer Venerable Sangabopura Akhila Hero for his support for this historical event. Without his technical assistance, we would not be able to organize this event successfully. He is an expert in computer technology, and he extended his support for the previous work. So, and I recall his support with a deep sense of gratitude. Finally, I would like to express my sincere thanks to Senior Lecturer Upul Jayanta Ranepura, Unit Head of the Drama, Theatre and Image Art Unit of the Department of Fine Arts, and Professor Patrick Ratnayake for their valuable advice and support. It is my sincere hope that this program will be helpful and beneficial to expand your knowledge of Buddhist Psychology and Counseling. I wish you all a very good day. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Senior Professor, the Head of the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies, Most Venerable Makurupe Dhammananda Mahathera. Next, I respectfully and cordially invite Senior Professor and Emeritus Professor of Pali and Buddhist Studies, Professor Sumana Pala Galmangota, to deliver the lecture. You all know that Emeritus Professor Sumana Pala Galmangota is one of the foremost professors of Pali and Buddhist Studies, not only in Sri Lanka, but in the entire ASEAN region. He is the scholar who initiated Buddhist studies related to psychology, psychotherapy, and counseling. He has done a vast amount of lectures, researches, academic articles, and he has prepared syllabuses for many universities in this field. Therefore, in the entire ASEAN region, as we know, he is the senior most professor to talk about this subject. So we are privileged today to listen to Emeritus Professor Sumana Pala Galmangota on this theme. Sir, here the stage is open for you.
Thank you very much, Venerable Sir. Good evening, everybody, Venerable Sirs, gentlemen, scholars, and all. And we are very happy to welcome you for this program, especially as the head of the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies, University of Caledonia Nanchang, Venerable Senior Professor Venerable Makurupe Dhammananda Thera. He explained the purpose of this short course. Actually, we did one several weeks ago in Sinhala medium because of the request made by many friends. We wanted to start this program in English medium. However, I should mention some facts before I start this lecture. I was a lecturer of this university, and I served here nearly 40 years, and after that I retired. But the head of the department, Senior Professor Venerable Makurupe Dhammananda Thera, and all other members, staff members, requested the university to appoint me as an emeritus professor. And after that, I resumed my duties again as a visiting professor. And now I think we are very fortunate. Our department has a new program, has new programs launched all the time. And this is one of them. And this, actually, in this department, there are professors, senior lecturers, and other lecturers who are experts in these subjects, especially Pali, Buddhist philosophy, and Buddhist culture. They are also teaching here, especially in the department, we have one course on Buddhist psychology. All are lecturers here. But however, I have been given this chance to talk on this course because this particular program, what we call Buddhist psychology, psychotherapy, and counseling, together with some Ayurvedic aspects, this was introduced by me about, I think, 10 years before, and it was in progress over the past period of time, and that is why I have I am only I am involved in this program. but otherwise all are experts in these subjects. This is a new trend, or actually we can say it is not a new thing, but however, it is a new interpretation based on the Buddha's teachings. This is a new theory and practice. That is why I undertook this task, that is this course. Before we go into the subject, I think I have to clarify some facts at the beginning. Especially, you know, Buddhist teachings. Buddha has given these Buddhist teachings at the very beginning, not as an academic subject, but anyway, it includes both theory and practice. The Buddha has an epithet called Vijjācarana. Vijjācarana means he is sent out with knowledge and conduct both. Therefore, Buddhism from the beginning was a practical one. Therefore, I think this practical aspect is very important in Buddhism. However, we have many studies related to Buddhism in all over the world. But however, this practical aspect, although we emphasize its importance, but we have not introduced some important programs to put these teachings into practice. That is why we have planned this program in counseling psychotherapy. And I think most of you are familiar with the fundamental Buddhist teachings, but however, there are newcomers to Buddhist field. Therefore, at the beginning, I hope to introduce the main principles of Buddhism in brief. Because especially, you know, within a short period of time, we cannot give a brief account of all Buddhist teachings belonging to Buddhist philosophy. But however, my aim is to explain the fundamental teachings of Buddhism, which are very relevant to our purpose, that is psychotherapy and counseling. Therefore, at the beginning, I have to tell you, any program, any institute, or even the personal life also should have two things. That means vision and mission. Vision means the purpose, aim, goal. And mission means the activities that we conduct to achieve that purpose. Vision and mission. I think according to modern sciences, especially management, you have heard about these two aspects, vision and mission. I think according to Buddhism, I think for the first time in the history of mankind, Buddha has given these two statements in brief in the 6th century BC in India. Because we know these two statements, vision statement and mission statements, are given in brief. Likewise, we find in the Vinaya, in the Mahavagga Pali, etc., because there are five texts belonging to Vinaya Pitaka, Buddha's teachings are classified into three sections, Sutta, Vinaya, and Abhidhamma. Sutta Pitaka, the collection of the suttas, so discourses. It includes 19 books. Diga Madhyama Sangha, Pali, Mahavagga Pali, and Parivara Pali. And also we have Abhidhamma Pitaka, consisting of 7 books. Dhamma Sangha Nibbanta Katavattu. Pungala Panyatti, Dhamma Sangha Nibbanta Katavattu, Uggala Panyati Yamata Pathana Kathavattu. Then you know, among these three pitakas or three collections, Vinaya Pitaka includes the Buddha's vision and mission in regard to the Buddhist clergy. That means Buddhist monks and nuns. And also in the Sutta Pitaka, we find vision and mission for the lay people. Therefore, at the beginning, before we understand the nature of Buddhist philosophy in connection with psychotherapy and counseling, I think it should be understood well. Because for anything, we should have a purpose and we should have a planning. That is called mission, right? Then, as far as the Buddhist Sangha is concerned, Buddhist monks and nuns, they renounce the household life and they become monks and nuns. At the time of their ordination, they request their preceptors or teachers this statement, that is the vision. Sabba dukkha nissarana nibbana sacchi karanattaya imam kasavan gahitva pabbajetamam bhanti. O Venerable Sir, having taken these robes, please ordain me in order to make an end to the mass of suffering indicated by birth, disease, decay and death. This is the vision. Vision of Buddhist monks and nuns. They have a definite vision. That means to make an end to the mass of suffering. That is the vision. And what is the mission? We know, according to the Buddhist history, after enlightenment, Buddha gave his first sermon to the five monks. And after that, Prince Yasakulan, his 54 friends, all of them got ordination with that vision. And after became arahant, after attaining arahantship, all the 60 arahants were there in the world for the first time. Then, addressing all the 60 arahants, Buddha gave his mission statement. What is that mission statement? Charata bhikkave charikam bahujana hitaya bahujana sukhaya atta hitaya sukhaya devamanussana. Deseta bhikkave dhammang adi kalyanam madhya kalyanam pariyosana kalyanam sattham sabhyanjanam kevala paripunnam parisuddham brahmacharyam pakas. This is the mission statement of the Buddha for the monks and nuns. What is that? Charata bhikkave charikam, go forth, O brethren. Go forth, don't stay in one place. Go forth, go from home to home, village to village, city to city, country to country. For what? Deseta bhikkave dhamma, please preach the dhamma. For what? For the sake of human beings and deities. And what should include? What is the nature of the dhamma that you hope to propagate? It should be adi kalyanam, madhya kalyanam, pariyosana kalyanam. It should be good at the beginning, good in the middle, and good at the end. And sattham sabhyanjana. It should include meaning and sound both. And parisuddha, it should be pure teachings leading to the highest life. Then that is the mission statement of the Buddha. Now it is very clear for the Buddhist monks and nuns in Buddhism, there is a very clear vision and mission. They have got their ordination in order to make an end to the mass of suffering by realizing Nibbana, the final aim of Buddhism. And their purpose or mission or their action to achieve that purpose was, after achieving that, they have to propagate Dhamma, deliver the Dhamma for the sake of all beings. then you know in modern terms what is this mission. This is actually counseling, nothing else. This is counseling. The Buddhist term for counseling is anusasana. Anusasana. It is not only advice, but also it includes listening, understanding, and advice. Right? Actually, Buddha and his disciples and all other community of Sangha for over 2,500 years have done this great service. Then today also we are conducting the same. Therefore, counseling means nothing else but Buddhist mission. And also I have to tell you, there is an opinion, especially I have seen in the articles written by Professor K.N. Jayatilaka. He has mentioned as an opinion, even the term therapy, you know, psychotherapy, Buddhist therapy, etc. we use. The therapy, I think, according to that opinion, this term has come from Buddhism, Buddhist tradition. We know King Ashoka in India in the 3rd century BC, after holding the 3rd Buddhist Council, sent 9 missionary groups to propagate Buddhism throughout the world, especially to 9 states of India and countries. Sri Lanka, Burma, Thailand are also included in them. In this area of Burma, Myanmar and Thailand were called at Bhumi. And also one missionary group went to the Greece, Yonaka Desa. According to the opinion, for the first time in that area, people witnessed this counseling service, because Buddhist monks are going from home to home, village to village, city to city, instructing the people and listening to the people. Then this tradition is something new for those people. Therefore, I think, according to that opinion, they have derived the term therapy from there. Actually, those who propagated Dhamma, they were called Theras. Thera means elder, elders, members of the Buddhist Sangha. Then from the Thera, the term Thera has derived the term therapy. Maybe it is an opinion. Therefore, you know, counseling is not a new thing to Buddhist tradition. It is Buddhist mission. And for the lay people also, we can see these two aspects. That means vision and mission. We refer to one of the famous instances in Dhammapada as the vision of lay people in Buddhism. Arogya paramalabha, physical well-being. Santutti paraman dhanam, mental well-being. Vissasa paramanyati, social well-being. Nibbanam paramam sukham, spiritual well-being. This is the vision of the lay people. They need to establish their physical well-being and also mental well-being and also social well-being. That means that they should live in the society in harmony, in unity. And also, although we are engaged in various activities in life for the happiness of this world, but finally, all of us have to face with birth, decay, disease, and death. Therefore, we should have some measures or some answers to these eternal questions. All of us have to be reborn, or we have to become old. We have to face with illnesses. We have to die. Then this is a big problem that all of us are facing today. And in the past, in the future, also say. Therefore, the answer that is given in Buddhism to solve this final problem is called the spiritual well-being. If we follow this path, then we would get a satisfactory answer to this problem. Therefore, even in the World Health Organization, they also state the former three: physical well-being, mental well-being, and social well-being. But however, including the spiritual well-being, all these four purposes of life have been expressed in Buddhism in the 6th century BC. And also, there are diverse opinions regarding the spiritual well-being. That is why some are reluctant to explain it. But as far as Buddhism is concerned, no problem. It is common to all, because all of us are subject to birth, decay, disease, and death. Then if we have to follow any method in order to make an end to those problems, that is called spiritual well-being. Right? Therefore, I think that there is no argument. Actually, all these things, physical well-being, mental well-being, social well-being, and spiritual well-being, these are common to all. Right? However, at the beginning, we have to understand these things. Then what is the mission of lay people? It is expressed in several places in the Buddha's teachings. One is explained in the Sigala Sutta. Actually, according to the Buddha's time, the society was classified into six. That means parents, teachers, wives and children, friends and relatives, workers, and religious people. There are six groups of people in the society. Actually, even today, in most of the societies, we can see these groups. In every society, there are parents, there are teachers, there are wives and children, there are relatives and friends, and also there are clergy, the religious leaders, and also there are workers, right? Therefore, it is a common thing for every society. Then towards these six groups of people in the society, we have to perform our duties. Each and every group, a person in the society has duties for each and every group of the society. Then if we are performing our duties perfectly towards these groups of people in the society, that is our mission. That is the mission. And also, in addition to these social activities, we have to develop our soft skills. It is also included in the mission of the lay people. Developing the soft skills. What are the soft skills? There are seven: Saddhadhanam, Siladhanam, Faith. Faith is one of the soft skills. That means actually we should have confidence. Confidence is very important while living in a society. We have to believe others. Right? If there is no confidence in each other, I think that in that society, we cannot expect harmony. That is faith. Right? And we should be faithful to the society, to the environment. Right? That is faith. Saddhadhanam, Siladhanam, moral training. Because without moral training, we cannot live in this world happily, because our desires are limitless. Our resources are very limited. All people, all beings in the world have to depend on the resources. Therefore, we should have some kind of control over the sense faculties. Actually, we enjoy the life through our sense faculties. Then if we let the sense faculties to enjoy limitlessly, I think it will be a big problem for the world to create harmony. Therefore, I think, according to Buddhism, one of the soft skills is to develop moral ideas, or we have to get moral training, right? Moral training means actually verbal and physical behavior. It directly affects for the mentality. Tadhadanam siladanam hiri ottapyantanam. There are two things, hiri and ottap, shamefulness and fearfulness of doing wrong things. That those two are also very good. Actually, in some discourses, Buddha has mentioned that these two are the leaders of the world. World is led by these two qualities. That means if all people in the world are shameful for doing wrong things and fearful for doing wrong things, I think the society will be a very comfortable place. And hiriyottapyandara sutadhana should be, we should have a good education. Sutta is an educational activity. But however, you know, at that time, people were educated by teaching verbal communication. That is why much heard. Sutta means much heard. We should have heard much. Then if that means in that period, people got their knowledge by listening. Right? Actually, nowadays also, we are using this, although we have developed the technological instruments, but still this verbal communication is very important than the visual education. But however, people say in modern society, visual education is more influential than audio, than the hearing, right? But however, you know, once we get the education through the eyes, that means by using our eye, if we study something through visuals, I think there is no much concentration. Because once we see something, it's finished. Oh, I have seen that. Finished. But you know, through the ear, when we hear, actually, we have to use our thinking process more deeply than seeing, because we have to identify the sound. Sound is related to the language. Then you know the interconnection between sounds and meanings. That means we have to learn a language, right? Then what? Actually, it is not complete. We don't know all the words in language, right? But when we hear a language, we understand all the words, whether we know or not, don't know the meaning, but we can understand according to the context. That means, you know, much of reflection is used in understanding the speech through the ear. Therefore, our thinking ability is more increased, more developed by hearing than seeing, right? Therefore, than the visual teaching, this hearing is more important. That is why Bahu Sutta, actually we have to learn much by hearing, right? However, it is also a quality that we have to develop under the mission of the lay people, right? Saddha dhanam, sila dhanam, giri ottappiyam dhanam, sutta dhanam, chaga. The other one is generosity, that we have to exchange, we have to give, right? That is, you know, the friendship is developed by exchanging things between the among the people, right? And also we develop our friendship in the society by this practice. Danam sila saddha danam sila danam giri ottappiyam danam sutta danam chaga panya. The last one, seventh one, is wisdom. Wisdom means not knowledge, but the internal understanding. That means, you know, we need, in addition to our general knowledge, but we should have an insight. It should be developed, right? Then these are the soft skills that we have to develop as the mission of the lay people. And we, in addition to that, we have to perform our duties that I mentioned in regard to the Sigala Sutra. And also, according to the management system, we should have, even for the personal life, we should have a vision and mission. That means we should have a purpose, and we should have some activities that should be followed in order to achieve that purpose. And also, in order to follow this, activate this mission, in order to put into action all these missionary works, we should have a planning. Without the planning, we cannot go along the activities, because they are very complicated, because there are many activities that we have to do in the society. We have to develop our economic side, health, and also health, economics, politics, etc., religious side, etc. There are many sides, many, many parts of the life. Every part should be developed as a layperson. For that purpose, we should have planning. We should have a plan, like in management, right? Planning occupies very important place in activities or in missionary works or in mission. Therefore, in Buddhism, actually we have a very definite planning. That planning includes three main parts. That means three main stages: sila, samadhi, and panya. This is the one and only plan. It's a general plan. There are particular plans separately, but however, this plan is common to all Buddhist activities, and it is common to both clergy and lay people. And in another way, we introduced these threefold training system as Noble Eightfold Path. But however, the wider concept is threefold training system. That means sila, samadhi, panya, morality, concentration, and wisdom. We have to understand this plan not only in the highest level. When we study these three in Buddhist context, we always refer to the highest level. Then, you know, in the highest level, in the spiritual level, sila means observing 5 precepts, 8 precepts, 10 precepts, precepts relevant to the novices, precepts relevant to the monks, etc. You know, that is the highest level. And when we refer to concentration, samadhi, we refer to the first trance, second trance, third trance, fourth trance, and formless sphere trances, form sphere trances, 4 or 5. Then there are 4 trances related to the formless sphere: akasa, vijnanam chayatana akinchan jayatana deva sanjana sanjaya. But I am not going to explain them in detail because now I am explaining the purpose. And you know, then when we refer to concentration, we refer only to four jhanic experiences in the form sphere and another four jhanic experiences belonging to the formless system. That is the highest level. And when we refer to the wisdom or panya, we refer to the highest level. That means realization of the Four Noble Truths, realization of Dipa. But remember, these three aspects, Sila, Samadhi, Panya, morality, concentration, and wisdom, have three levels, you know, bottom level, lower level, middle level, and higher level. Then the higher level refers to those things in Buddhism. But I am talking about these three aspects in the lower level, grassroots level. If we take in those level, in that level, sila means behavioral therapy. If we use it as a therapy, it is called behavioral therapy, right? And second one is called mental therapy or psychotherapy. It is related to the mental. And panya is cognitive therapy, right? In the lower level, behavioral therapy, psychotherapy, and cognitive therapy. Even in the Western tradition also, I am not an expert in Western tradition, but however, as far as I know, maybe I am not correct fully, but however, as I have read, you know, Sigmund Freud presented the theory called psychoanalytic model. According to him, our experiences, especially as he mentions in the childhood experiences, are stored up in the bottom of the mind, which is called unconsciousness. And also, those oppressed ideas, because people have two trends, two mental trends, sex and aggression. In Buddhism, we have three. Sex means actually, although we don't use that term, sex means lust, greed, craving, right? And aggression means hate, lobha, lobha dvesha, greed, hatred. Then Buddhism says another one, delusion. Actually, we have to understand this in a proper way. Later we can deal with that. But however, this is the definition. You know, people have two trends, two mental trends, likes and dislikes. In order to live in this world, we need these two trends. Because without these two trends of mind, we cannot live happily. We want to get what we like. For that, we should have desire or likes. We have to reject what we don't like or what is dangerous to us. That trend, mental trend, is called dislike. Right? These two are essential. But however, according to the changing nature of the world, because world is based on cause and effect theory, everything is related as causes and effects. Therefore, whole world is in a flux, always changing. In a changing world, we cannot get everything that we like, and we cannot reject everything that we don't like. Therefore, all the time, we are failed. In most cases, we are failed to achieve these two purposes, to get what we like and to reject what we don't like. Therefore, always in the mind, there is unrest. Unrest is essential. Always in an ordinary mind, there is an unrest. But it is called unrest, right? Unrest means it is also a little mental problem. That is why, you know, all ordinary beings are experiencing these things, life, dislikes and unrest. Unrest is a byproduct because we cannot achieve our purpose, and that means we want to get what we like and we want to reject what we don't like, right? That old age, death, disease, we don't like, no? But food, clothes, houses, money, etc., we like. Then we are trying all the life, in all the life, to get what we like and to reject what we don't like for our survival. But you know, in those efforts, we are not 100% successful. Therefore, every day we lose something. Therefore, a little unrest is always inside the mind. Therefore, that is why, you know, in Buddhism it is said that Sabbe putujjana ummataka, all ordinary beings are like mad people. Like mad people. But some criticize this saying of Buddhism, because how can we say all ordinary beings are like mad men? It is not good. Some criticize that. But you know, in a recent in a psychology work that I read, its title is Psychology, the Science of Human Behavior by Sherpard. You can see at the beginning of that book this statement, right? That's called, Sherpard says, you should not ask the question from anyone, are you mad? Don't ask. Why? It is understood. He says, no need to ask the question, are you mad? It is understood. Then he says, we have to ask the question from everyone, what is the percentage of your madness? Then this saying is okay in Buddhism also. All ordinary beings are like mad people, right? It is okay in modern psychology also, they accept that. Because we have a little bit unrest. Then now you know the basic level is likes, dislikes, and unrest. But you know, likes and dislikes have no limit. No one can say, oh, I like these things only. Cannot say. And also no one can say, I don't like these things only. No, limitless. Therefore, you know, unknowingly, internally, we are developing these two sides, likes and dislikes. Then comes to the second level. When we develop these likes to the middle level, we call greed, right? It is unwholesome. It is not wholesome. That is what Buddhism says. Greed, hatred, and delusion are unwholesome, right? Then unknowingly, the unlikes, dislikes are developed up to the hatred. And greed, hatred. Then you know, unrest, that normal unrest is increased up to delusion, right? Then now, in the second stage, we get greed, hatred, and delusion. Buddhism says unwholesome, not the likes, dislikes, and unrest, but greed, hatred, and delusion. Then this second stage is further developed up to the third stage. What are those? Abhijja, vyapada, michaditti. These are called unwholesome mental actions. Abhijja means covetousness. That means we are acting in the society now, motivated by greed, right? And ill will, the second one is ill will. Now we are acting in the society. And third one is wrong view. That means we are acting in the society, propagating our wrong views. Those three are called unwholesome mental actions, right? Then, you know, these three stages of the development. That is why Buddhism says, and Sigmund Freud says, sex and aggression. It means lust and hate, right? But anyway, it should be added even by delusion or unrest, right? That's what I wanted to tell you. And you know, these three trends are common to all. All mental problems are rooted in it. These three aspects, right? Greed, hatred, and delusion, and also avijja vyapada nitya vrutti covetousness, ill will and wrong view and beginning likes, dislikes and unrest. This is the development of mental conditions of the ordinary beings. And also we are given a planning. Now I was talking about the plan, right? In this plan, we have three stages: sila, samadhi, panya. That means moral training, concentration, and wisdom in the highest sense. But in the normal level, these three means, as far as psychotherapy is concerned, behavioral therapy, psychotherapy, and cognitive therapy. Then Sigmund Freud introduced this psychotherapy. It is called psychoanalytic model. He says that there are repressed ideas in the childhood, oppressed ideas. They come up to the middle level, that is called subconscious and subconscious level, and they are put into action, right? Then in that case, we have to take effort to repress those ideas that come up to the front level from the bottom level. Then we have to spend some amount of psychic energy to repress them. That is why people become ill, right? The mental illnesses arise because of that, right? That is the that is one model that is called psychoanalytic model. We can deal with later with this. And that is the psychoanalytic model presented by Sigmund Freud. And also the another therapeutic model is behavioral model presented by John B. Watson. John B. Watson, right? Then he says that in order to find the mental problems, we have to, and also in order to solve the mental problems, we have to investigate into the behavior of the person, right? He emphasizes the behavioral pattern. Once we change the behavior, then mentality is changed. That is called behavioral model. Then you know, in Buddhism, what is psychoanalytic model means panya. And also samadhi. Samadhi and panya. Samadhi means mental or psychotherapy. Panya means cognitive therapy. Both these aspects refer to the mental problems, right? Therefore, the psychoanalytic model of Sigmund Freud can be connected with samadhi and panya, that means psychotherapy and cognitive therapy. And the behavioral model presented by Watson can be connected with sila. It is moral behavior, right? Behavioral therapy. That means, you know, sila means, morality means kaya vachana samodhana sila. Restrainment of the verbal and physical behavior is called morality. That means, you know, we have to restrain the moral behavior. These three aspects are included in all kinds of Buddhist activities, right? That is, every plan of Buddhism should include these three aspects. That means behavioral training, mental training, and training of understanding, right? Cognitive training. These three are essential. And the same three are connected with the Noble Eightfold Path. That means, you know, right view and right concepts, right thoughts are called the Samma Ditti and Samma Sankappa. It is connected with the general understanding, right? It is not wisdom. Although we say that it is connected with wisdom, but you know, in wisdom, there are no views, right? Samma Ditti. Ditti means view. Therefore, Samma Ditti and Samma Sankappa, right view and right thoughts, are related to the general understanding. Because before we start something, we should have a general understanding of that. Therefore, we should have a general understanding. It is an intellectual activity, right? Actually, if we ask someone to follow one path, then he will question, what for? What is this? That is called general understanding. Then you know we start with morality, moral behavior. Samma vacha, samma kammanta, samma ajiva, right? The right speech, right actions, and right livelihood. These three aspects of the Noble Eightfold Path refer to the moral behavior, right? Behavioral path. And next three, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. Samma vayama, samma sati, samma samadhi. These three aspects of the Noble Eightfold Path are related to the concentration. That means mental therapy or psychotherapy. Then you know what happens now. First of all, through the first two limbs, that means samma ditti and samma sankappa, right view and right thoughts. By these two, we get a general understanding. Then after following the next two stages, that means morality and concentration, what happens? That general understanding becomes a personal realization. And it is no need to add anything, because it is understood that the general understanding becomes a personal experience after following these two stages. Then it is called panya, wisdom, right? Then this is the planning, common planning for all Buddhist activities. But however, we should have different planning systems for other activities. Therefore, you know, Buddhist training system, right, or Buddhist mission is included in three levels, right, in three levels. And also, you know, there is another model presented in the Western tradition, what we call biological model, as far as psychotherapy is concerned, right? Psychoanalytic model, behavioral model, and biological model, especially presented by Kraepelin. Then you know this biological model, it means that they try to connect the mental illnesses mainly to the brain or physical body, right? Therefore, I think they get more support from the medicines, right? Medicines are given to solve the mental problems, because mental illnesses are connected with the physical ailments. But however, you know, as far as Buddhism is concerned, this aspect, biological model, is related to the moral behavior. Because, you know, actually in Buddhism, we have a new concept, what we call a medical food concept. Medicinal food concept. Medicinal food concept. It is mentioned in the Vesajja Khandaka of Vinaya Pitaka. It is mentioned that Buddha has recommended many kinds of foods and drinks which serve not only as medicine but also as food. Therefore, you know, in Asian tradition, all kinds of foods and drinks that we used serve as medicines as well as food. Therefore, no need to separate medicine from food. But however, in Western tradition, they have this difference. That means they take medicine separately and they take food and drinks separately. But they also believe that in food and drinks, there are medicinal values. But however, you know, in Asian tradition, according to Buddhism, from the beginning, if we follow this medicinal food system, food concept, that means if we prepare our foods and drinks in accordance with our health problems, then no need to take medicine addition, right? Then our foods and drinks themselves are medicine. Then that is what in Buddhism we find in this course. I will introduce them in brief. There are many medicinal plants and foods, drinks, etc. recommended in order to reduce the physical problems. And also in this case, we have to understand, actually we will go in go to details later, right? In brief, now keep in mind, this is when we are studying Buddhist psychology, psychotherapy and counseling, we have to understand these fundamental things. What is the mission of Buddhism? What is the vision of Buddhism? Mission and mission. Actually, I explained it in relation to Buddhist clergy and also lay people, right? In brief, if I remind you again, you know, the mission of Buddhist monks and nuns is to make an end to the mass of suffering related to birth, disease, decay, and death. And their mission is to propagate the Dhamma, that means counseling. They have to propagate Dhamma for the sake of all beings. That is their mission. And I explained the mission of lay people is to develop their physical health, mental health, social well-being. Physical well-being, social, physical well-being, mental well-being, social well-being, and spiritual well-being. And in their activities, that means in their mission, they have to do other things. That means they should have a plan. General plan in Buddhist activities is Sila Samadhi Panya. That means morality, concentration, and wisdom. In more simple level, in a simple level, these three means behavior. In as far as the psychotherapy is concerned, in the simple level, this means behavioral therapy, mental psychotherapy, and cognitive therapy. And also, this is the common plan for all missionary activities. And also, as lay people, we have to do our duties. That means related to six groups of the society: parents, teachers, wives and children, friends and relatives, clergy, and workers. And also, in addition to those social activities, we have to develop soft skills. That means faith, saddha, morality, saddhadana, dhiradana, hiri, shamefulness, and fearfulness of doing wrong things, hiriyottapyantana, suddhadana, education, suttadharancha chaga, generosity, chagocha, panya, the development of wisdom. These are the soft skills that we have to develop. The others are social activities that we have to do. All these activities should be carried out in a plan. That general plan for clergy and for lay people in Buddhism is the same. It includes three stages: morality, concentration, and wisdom. And also, in detail, it has eight limbs: right to speak, right view, right thoughts, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. Then now I have explained these things. These are the fundamentals. Further, now we have to go to the Buddhist philosophy. This is the fundamental thing. These are the fundamental things that we have to keep in mind when dealing with Buddhism. Then, you know, Buddhist philosophy means, in this context, my aim is to explain Buddhist philosophy or Buddhist psychology as far as psychotherapy and counseling are concerned. Right, there are many details in Buddhist philosophy, but however, in this context, I think I have to explain it in brief. Then, in this regard, I will tell you, as far as Buddhist psychology, Buddhist psychotherapy and counseling are concerned, we have to learn only two things in brief. Therefore, you can keep them very easily in mind. Only two factors, two theories we have to understand, right? At the beginning, I have to say, but those two concepts are very, very wide, right? Very deep. I think it will take several years to understand those two concepts, right? Only two things, two subjects. Throughout this course, I explain only these two, right? Now let us take theory and then we take practice. Practice I have explained to some extent with reference to the morality, concentration and wisdom. That means three stages. That is the practice. That is the one and only practice. All practices are connected with these three stages, right? Now I am going to explain the theory, right? I will further explain these three practices later, but now I have to explain in brief what is Buddhist psychology, Buddhist philosophy or theory, because there is a very famous saying, theory without technique is blind. Theory, in your note, I have mentioned that, theory without practice is blind. We don't know where to go. Theory means vision. Technique means mission, right? If there is no theory, only techniques is available, that we don't know where we go. Therefore, theory without technique is blind. And technique without theory is empty, right? Theory without technique is empty, because if there is no practice, technique, we cannot get results, no? Therefore, you know, both of them should go together. Theory and practice. Then practice I explain in brief. Morality, concentration and wisdom, behavioral therapy, mental therapy and cognitive therapy. Now I am going to explain the theoretical aspect. Theoretical aspect I explain in Buddhism in relation to the five grasping groups. I think most Buddhist scholars have heard this. Five grasping groups or five aggregates in simple way. Right, five grasping groups. The personality or human being has been analyzed into five parts. Right? What are those five parts? In Pali we call Rupa, Vedana, Sanya, Sankhara, Vinya. Form. Form means physical body. Right? Feelings or sensations or emotional aspect. Right? Form, feeling, perceptions. Perceptions means memory. Memory is mental aspect. Sankhara means concepts that we have developed. Consciousness means the concept of I-ness, the concept of soul, the self-we. I will explain them in detail, right? They are interconnected. Then five aggregates represent the whole world, not only the person, but his related world. Everything is related to these five. Therefore, we have to keep in mind whatever mental problem or physical problem arises, all those physical and mental illnesses should be connected with these five. Then without understanding these five factors, we cannot understand what are the mental and physical illnesses. Actually, Venerable Buddha Bosa, in his Visuddhi Magga, English translation is Path of Purity and Path of Purification. There are two translations, one by PTS, Polytech Society, Path of Purity. The other one by Venerable Jnana Tiloka, I think, Path of Purification. In that book, Venerable Buddha Bosa mentions, or he compares the five aggregates with the hospital, right? Hospital. The form or physical body is compared with the hospital, right? The physical body is like a hospital. And the feeling, the second one, feeling is compared with the disease or illness. Illness is compared to feeling. And perception or memory is compared to the rising of illness, and sankhara or concepts are compared with taking unsuitable food and drinks to increase the illness. It is similar to that. And consciousness is compared with the patient. Then therefore, you know, you can understand the importance of psychotherapy as far as five aggregates are concerned. There are many analyses in Buddhism regarding the person and the world. But this particular analysis of five aggregates are very, very important. I have taken only this analysis into five aggregates because throughout the history of Buddhism, many scholars in the ancient times also have based their philosophical analysis on these five aspects. For example, let us say, if you take Theravada Abhidhamma, right? Theravada Abhidhamma, I don't know, all of you are not aware of that, but if you are aware of the Theravada Abhidhamma, there are four realities. Chitta, Chetasika, Rupa, Nibbana. Nibbana means final aim, but the world is included in here. Chitta means consciousness, mental concomitants, and matter, right? Mind and matter. Mind has divided into two parts, mind and thoughts, and then matter. Then you know, in these three divisions, then in Theravada Abhidhamma, mind is analyzed into 121 parts. Mental concomitants or thoughts have been analyzed into 52 parts. And matter is analyzed into 28 parts. Until actually the atomic level also is available there. Up to the atomic level, matter is analyzed in Abhidhamma. Then you know these three parts of Abhidhamma are based on five aggregates. That means form means matter or form, rupa, is analyzed into 28 material elements in Abhidhamma. Then you know mental concomitants or thoughts means feeling, perception, and concepts. Right? That means feeling, the traditionally feelings, perceptions, and dispositions. That means these three aspects have been analyzed, including feelings and perceptions are taken separately. Then concepts or dispositions have been analyzed into 50, then altogether 52. Then 52 thoughts have been analyzed in relation to the feelings, perception, and disposition. Then consciousness, chitta, has been analyzed into 89 or 121 parts. Then rupa is analyzed in Abhidhamma into 28 parts. Now, what is whole Abhidhamma means? Five aggregates. In the seven books of the Abhidhamma Pitaka has explained all these parts. Then you can understand the wider range of five aggregates. And if you take other Abhidharmic traditions, you know, for example, Sarvastivada Abhidhamma, it is another tradition belonging to Buddhism, it has, you know, matter is analyzed into, rupa is analyzed into 11, and mental concomitants have been analyzed into 46, right? And consciousness is analyzed into one part, but with all divisions and subdivisions. And if we take Sautrantika tradition, you know, they are, in the Sautrantika Buddhist tradition, rupa is matter is analyzed into 8, feelings are analyzed into 3, perceptions are analyzed into 6, and dispositions are analyzed into 20, right? And mind is analyzed into 6. Like that, you know, in different Buddhist traditions, even in Mahayana, you know, in Mahayana Yogacara tradition, they have analyzed all these five aggregates into 100 parts, right? Like that, you know, in every Buddhist tradition, the analysis of the person and the related world are confined to five aggregates. That is why I take five aggregates as the basis of psychology in Buddhism, right? Then let us take this, you know, the five aggregates, actually the five aggregates, you know, are very important in connection with the, actually, you know, five aggregates. Now you can understand that I told you only two things we have to understand, right? What are the two things? Threefold training system and five aggregates. Five aggregates. Threefold system and the five aggregates. That means these two things are very wider concepts. We have to understand them in a deep level and in a wider context, right? In various contexts, we can develop these two ideas, right? Then I will begin with the threefold training system first, right? Threefold training system, that means Sila, Samadhi, Pajna. Once again, if you keep in your mind, the Sila means moral behavior. Moral behavior, right? I told you that it is behavioral therapy, right? Behavioral therapy. And Samadhi means psychotherapy. And Panya means cognitive therapy. Then these three are the therapeutic measures, right? Because I told you that these three are therapeutic measures. Therefore, I told you the five aggregates are the basis of all illnesses, right? Physical and mental. Then in modern texts on Buddhism, no one compares these two. How to apply these three therapeutic measures into the five aggregates? I think you have you seen anywhere? No. They are talking about the threefold training system, and also they analyze the five aggregates. But no one says how to apply these three measures to solve the problem related to five aggregates. That's the problem. Now I am going to explain it, right? It is my new interpretation. Form means body, form, feeling, perception, disposition, and consciousness. Now let us take from the beginning. Form means body. Body means matter, right? When we say matter, not only the physical body, the related material world also included there. Then when we say body, it means five senses, five physical senses, eye, ear, nose, tongue, and skin, right? These are the five senses that we use to contact with the external world. Through the eye, we see only the colors and shapes. Other things we cannot see. Varna and Santha. Because I can discern only the color and shape. There are two colors in the world, light and darkness. Dark colors means yellow, blue, all these are dark colors. Then white color, the other one. Then these two colors can be differentiated through the eye. And there are three shapes in the world, length, width, and height. Nothing else. Although there are some other shapes, our human eye cannot perceive them, right? These are the three. Because there is a story that, you know, I have read the book, Simplicity of Science. There is a story that there had been a scientist called Abbott, right? Then by that time, people understood only two dimensions in the world, length and width. But, you know, this scientist one day, when he was thinking about these light waves coming from the sun to the earth, he understood that in addition to length and width, there is another dimension called height. Then he informed all the people to gather in a hall to express this new idea. Then he gave a lecture. Up to date, we have thought that there are only two dimensions in the world, but I have found another dimension called height. Then after the lecture, he has been put into the mental hospital. Right, like that, you know, nowadays we have three dimensions, but there may be other dimensions also in the world. But human eye can discern only these three dimensions. Therefore, you know, human eye can see only color and shape. Then you know, these five senses contact with the material things in the external world through the eye forms, that means color and shape, through the ear sound, through the nose smell, through the tongue taste, through the skin touch. Touch means cold and heat. Now it is okay. But however, our five senses cannot perceive any object in the external world without the involvement of the mind. But according to modern explanations, they connect mind with the brain, right? But in Buddhism, there is a sixth sense faculty. There are six sense faculties. Sixth one is mind, mana, right? This sixth sense, that means mind has two functions. One function is that it helps the five sense faculties to perceive the objects. That is one action of the mind. The other one is the mind has its own independent thinking process, right? That means mind independently, depending on sense data, it creates feelings, perceptions, dispositions, and views, right? It is independent activity of the mind. But in addition to that, mind faculty supports the five senses to see, hear, smell, taste, and touch. Without that involvement of that mind, we cannot perceive the external world, right? Then I am explaining the interconnection of the five aggregates. The first one I explained, this rupa or form. Form means five senses of the body and their respective objects in the external world. Then when they contact, mind is involved. Then we become conscious. We become conscious of the form, sounds, smell, taste, and touch. Then there are three items come together in the first stage. Sense faculty, relative object, and mental awareness. Coming together of these three factors, right? Sense faculty, sense object, and related mental awareness produces a kind of feeling. Happy, unhappy, or indifferent. Because feeling, this is the mechanism of producing feelings. Why these senses and sense objects and the mentality produce feelings? Feeling is food, mental food that we need. According to Buddhism, there are four kinds of foods for the survival of beings. Edible food, kabalinkara ahara, feelings, emotional. Feelings are essential for living. We never do anything without a feeling, right? Therefore, feeling is a mental food, right? Kabalinkara ahara, mano sanketana ahara. It is the determinate concepts. We need concepts to lead this life. We are guided by the concepts. Then we have to build up the concepts also. And also, vijnana ahara, we need the self-concept. We have to develop self-idea of self-we. Otherwise, we cannot survive in the world. Because we have to say also, I am, I stay here, I do this, like that. But in reality, there is no such a person. But we develop that concept, self-view, in our mind to establish ourselves in the society. Therefore, these four kinds of foods, there are three are mental food, one is edible food. Therefore, for our survival, we need four kinds of foods. Out of them, three are mental food. But we always pay our attention mostly to the edible food. Therefore, we take more and more edible food. Then what happens? We are lacking of mental food. Then mental problems are increasing. Only physical problems are also increasing because we take too much food. That's the problem, right? Therefore, you know, however, the mechanism of producing these feelings is this: senses, sense objects, and mental areas. Then these feelings that we produce cannot be obtained all the time. Because suppose that if someone is going here, he is very beautiful, then I like to see him, right? But I cannot ask the person, please stop for a while because I like to see you and create some feelings. We will be in the danger, no? We cannot ask anyone to stop for a while until we experience the feeling, no? Then we have inherited an ability, mental ability, what we call perception, number three, right? Form, feeling, perception is memory. That means when I see something beautiful, and if I want to get feeling all the time from that object, I can remember it. That remembrance is called perception, right? Actually, sanya means sign. Then we keep that object in mind with the sign. What for? When we keep that sign in mind, at any time when we need that kind of feeling, we can reflect over it. We reflect over it and create the same feeling. Right? Therefore, you know, that is what we do actually. Right? In day-to-day life, we cannot experience the happiness at the time of experiencing it. Actually, at the time of experiencing, what we are experiencing is not happiness, but suffering, right? But after experiencing it, for example, let us say that we are eating a very delicious food, but at the time of eating, do you have happiness? Because we have to wash our hands, we have to devour it, swallow it, and drink water, and it is very uneasy task, no? And we have to use our spoons, etc. How many activities that we have to do in eating? But after eating, when we go back home, closing eyes, a very good meal today, like that, you know? And also, you know, for example, marriage. We think that marriage ceremony is very happy event. No, it is very difficult. You know, at the time of getting married, how many difficult things that we have to do? We have to spend money and we have to spend our time and we have to wear the special garments and we have to greet other people and we have to many, many activities, but very tiresome, no? But you know, after marriage ceremony, after some time, when we look at the album, happiness. That means we reflect over the memories and create the feeling. That is what we are doing. At the time of experiencing, it is not happiness, actually suffering. But however, you know, this ability we have, that means perception. When we experience a happiness, we keep it as a memory. That is perception, right? Then this is the interconnection. We have senses, sense objects, and mental awareness. Then there arises the kind of feeling. If it is necessary, we keep it. Whether it is a happy feeling or unhappy feeling, we keep that as a memory. Because sometimes unhappy feelings also, we keep in mind that when we meet the same person again, we get angry. Because unhappy feeling, no? We keep all the memory, all the feelings as memories. Then what happens, you know? Next one, form, feeling, perception. Perception means memory, yeah? Then there comes another one in between. Buddha explains, yam sanjanati tam vitakke. We reflect over the memories time to time. Right? Time to time, when we are in need, we reflect. For example, let us say that someone is called me. Then I get angry. Then it is over. Then after about 2-3 years, I forget it. Right? But that memory is kept in here. Then after 5 years, when I meet the person again, that memory is recalled, then I get angry again. Like that, you know, that we are recalling them and reflect over them again and again in order to create the feeling, same feelings. Then what happens? As a result of constant reflection over the memories, those memories are transformed into strong concepts. Those are called dispositions, concepts. Then, you know, concepts are more stronger than the memories. That concepts means, actually, the Buddha says that once we create the concepts, what happens? We are guided by the concepts, right? Tato nidanam purisam papancha sanyasam ka sabudacharam. We are the people who are building up those various concepts. But what happens finally? We are guided by the concepts, right? Now, actually, you know that when we see something, when we see someone, we are not seeing the person through our open eyes. We are seeing the person through the concept, right? Through the concept. That, for example, you know, suppose that I am a layman. But if I wear a yellow robe and I stay here, do you see Sumanapala here? No, you see, it is a Buddhist monk, you will say. That means you are looking at me through your concept of monk, no? Not actually, right? Like that, you know, concepts are very, very important as far as mentality is concerned. Because, you know, we are guided always by the concepts, not as human beings. Because for example, I am looking at everything as a Sinhalese person, Sri Lankan person, Buddhist person, etc. You know, all are concepts. We are guided by the concept. That is why Buddha instructs us, we can deal with them later. Actually, the most important and most deep level of mentality is disposition. We have deposited many things. As Sigmund Freud says, he also says that in our childhood, young age, we have repressed many ideas, stored up there. No? That means we have deposited them. And also, you know, according to Mahayana, analysis of the consciousness into three layers, Alaya Vijnana, Klishtamanas, Pravruti Vijnana. They also say that there are three stages of the mind. Alaya Vijnana means store consciousness. All our experiences are stored up there. They come to the middle level, and from there, they are activated in the front level, right? Like that. These three stages is nothing else. Every Buddhist tradition, we have three layers of the mind. Then in Theravada, we say, I have given in my lessons a graph also, you know, Anusaya, Pariyuttara, Vitikkam. Anusaya means latent dispositions. They come to the middle level and they come to the front level, right? Like that. It is a common idea, right? In all Buddhist tradition. Therefore, you know, these dispositions, actually, in Abhidhamma, dispositions have been analyzed into 50 parts, right? Feelings is one, perceptions one, but disposition into 50. And Vijnana, the fifth one, means nothing else. All these concepts, you know, all these are not static things. They are changing moment by moment. But what we do is, we want to establish our personality. There is nothing called personality. All our changing processes are going on, right? But however, we grasp these concepts as mine, right? That you see, I take a professor. I am a professor. I am a lecturer. I am a Buddhist. I am a Sri Lankan. Like that, you know, we take every idea as mine. Right? Then what happens? In our mind, the mentality of self is increasing, right? Then I am, we say, I-ness, we say. That idea is called Vijnana. Then these are the five aggregates. All mental problems are related to this. I will tell you one example, right? That you may think that how can I, we believe all the mental problems belong to this, but I will tell you one example, right? I will tell you this one, because even in modern psychology and psychotherapy, they also refer to these five aggregates, right? I will prove that. You know, this is called mental illness, its causes and treatments, Singapore Association for Mental Health, right? In this book, they explain, you know, even in modern psychoanalysis, they also refer to these aspects, nothing else. You know, form, feeling, perception, dispositions, and thinking. Thinking means actually building concepts, right? These are the five aspects. All mental disorders, and for example, later we can discuss in detail, you know, all mental disorders are grouped mainly into two sections. That means neurosis and psychosis, no? Then you see, the mental disorders belonging to neurosis, like stress, phobia, hysteria, anxiety, etc. What are those minor mental disorders? They are mostly emotional. Emotional means feelings, no? Feelings. The other one, you know, psychosis means mainly cognitive, right? Then, you know, among these five aspects of the five aggregates, form, feeling, and perception means emotional, right? It's emotional. And the dispositions and consciousness are cognitive. Then these two aspects are related to five aggregates, right? Then what I wanted to explain, you know, the three measures, that means behavioral therapy, mental psychotherapy and cognitive therapy, these three aspects are, three measures are applied to these five aggregates. That means, you know, the behavioral therapy is applied to form, rupa, because rupa means physical body. That is the restrainment of the verbal and physical behavior. That is the therapy that we need, that we call sila or behavioral therapy. Because without the restrainment of the behavior, we cannot heal the mental problems, right? That is the beginning. Every therapeutic measure should begin with the change of the lifestyle. Otherwise, we cannot cure, right? That is the first one. All the problems start from the body. That means our related to our senses. By seeing, eye, ear, nose, tongue, and skin, we see many things, we hear many things, we smell, and we eat many things, and we touch many things, right? Then because of these contact, there arise many problems in mind, right? Therefore, in order to cure all mental disorders without any discrimination, we should start from the restrainment of external behavior. Behavioral therapy is essential for all mental diseases, right? That's the beginning. Therefore, behavioral therapy is connected with the form. Then feelings and memories, feelings and perception. Perception means memory. These two aspects, in order to eliminate the mental problems related to feelings and memories, we have to apply the psychotherapy, mental therapy, because they are related to mental, the thinking process. That means, you know, especially according to our experience, more than 3,000 patients in our hospital, you know, all the mental problems related to form, feeling, and perception all those are young persons, because you know their sense faculties are very keen. Therefore, they like to enjoy the life. They are chasing after the enjoyment, right? Therefore, when they have problems of enjoying the life, they become mental problems. Therefore, young generation is always facing with the problems related to emotional aspect. They are connected with the form, feeling, and perception. Then what we have to do is to change the feeling, right? If we can give them more feelings, better than those, then we can change it. It is easier to change those feelings, right? But however, the next one, you know, dispositions and consciousness means the cognitive, intellectual aspect. They are relevant to the elderly people, right? Because now their sense faculties are weak, but now they are thinking more and more. Then elderly people have the problems, especially belonging to the cognitive aspect. Then we have to apply the third one, that means panya or wisdom or cognitive therapy, to solve the problems related to those cognitive aspects. Then this is the, that is why I tell you, there are only two things to study in Buddhist psychology, psychotherapy and counseling. What are the two things? Five aggregates and threefold training system. Five aggregates means form, feeling, perception, disposition, and consciousness. Threefold training system means behavioral therapy, mental therapy, cognitive therapy. And also, I have to tell you that, you know, these two aspects should be applied, right? Should be able to apply in different contexts. But unfortunately, modern time, in modern age, people are trying to solve many problems through intellectual methods or cognitive methods. That is very unfortunate, because, you know, today we have developed unnecessarily our knowledge, because limitless expansion of knowledge is a declining factor of the society. When people become more and more intelligent, the society or institution will go down. I think you don't accept, maybe, but however, it is the Buddhist saying. You know, intellect, if more and more develop, it is also a cause of downfall of an institute or of any society. Therefore, we should balance both emotional and intellectual. Both sides should be well balanced. Nowadays, what has happened, because of the modern education system, we have increased or developed our intellect to a higher level, but our emotional aspect is in a lower condition. But they say, they also say that we should have emotional stability. But according to Buddhism, no need more emotional stability. We have to develop the emotional aspect also up to the high level, right? Two levels should be there. Otherwise, you know, if we develop only the intellect, all are conflicting. Many conflicts arise because of intellect. Most dangerous things are done in the world by the intellectual people, but not uneducated people, right? Understand well, because the faith is the positive aspect of lust or craving. They are not harmful, they beautify the world, right? And negative aspect of intelligence is hate. We should not forget. Hate is developed positively as intelligence, right? Faith is developed as the positive aspect of lust or craving. Therefore, their basis should be concerned, because intellect is developed on hate, because we don't believe anything. We criticize everything. That means the hateful ideas, right? Therefore, if we develop the intellect unnecessarily, it may be very harmful for life. Therefore, you know, in our life, there are two things, intellect and emotion. Buddhism develops these two sides. In Buddhism, Buddha has developed these two sides up to the highest level. You know, emotional side is developed up to the highest level as compassion. And intellectual aspect has been developed up to the level of wisdom, karuna and panya. This Buddha has developed both sides to the highest level. Likewise, our life also should be developed in both the sides. But unfortunately, according to the modern educational system, we are developing only the intellect. Therefore, wind out, but today it is an introduction. I will wind out my explanation of these two sides by a short story. I always mention this story. You know, I got this story from a book called Psychology of Consciousness by Einstein. Robert Einstein, not Einstein, Robert Einstein. There he has given the very good story to indicate these two sides, right? Intellectual and emotional. Actually, according to the modern experiments in medicine, medical side also, they have identified two aspects of the brain, emotional aspect and intellectual aspect. The right brain is emotional, right? And left brain is intellectual, right? They have identified. Therefore, you know, these are two specific parts of the personality. Then, you know, according to this story, one person lost his key of his door, lost in the dark room of his house, dark room. Nowadays, dark rooms are available only in the studios. But in ancient times, in the village areas, in their houses, there was a dark room. Dark room means no windows. Even the daytime, it is dark. Then this person, owner of the house, one day lost his key in his dark room, right? In his dark room. Then in front of his house, there was a big ground. Then he went to the ground and was searching for his key. After some time, one of his friend was going by that way and asked, "What are you searching for?" Then he said that, "I lost my key and I am searching for that." Then he also began to search, because he was an emotional person. If he was an intellectual person, he would say, "Oh, I am sorry, I am in a busy, and I am sorry, I cannot help you and see you." He will go. But this is an emotional person. Therefore, he didn't say anything. He also started to search the key. Then after some time, his friend asked, "Can't you imagine that where you lost your key exactly? In which area?" "Yes, where?" "In the dark room of my house." "Then why are you searching it for in the playground? There is no light." And that's the problem. We are also doing the same thing. We want to solve all the problems in the intellectual way. The dark side is emotional, you know. Emotional means not intellectual. It is the dark side of our life. It is the emotions. Actually emotional side includes love, compassion, kindness, etc. They are called in Buddhism immeasurable, incalculables. They cannot be calculated, right? Actually, we have to live with emotional aspect. We have to build up or plan our life according to intellect. These two things are for two different purposes, right? But nowadays, unfortunately, we are trying to solve everything intellectually, right? Through science and technology. No, life has two aspects, emotional and intellectual. Intellectual aspect, we have to use to plan the life, right? To plan the life in every side. And while living as wife and husband, children, etc., as a family and friends and relatives, we have to use emotional side. Because of this difference, that means nowadays we are trying to live always in accordance with the intellectual level. That is why problems arise. Nowadays, throughout the world, the mental diseases are increasing more and more every year. Why? People are trying to solve all problems intellectually. No, we have to use in day-to-day life our emotional side. In five aggregates also, Rupa, Vedana, Sanya, form, perception, feeling and perception belongs to emotional side, and disposition and consciousness belong to the intellectual side. Therefore, you know, these two sides should be developed by using the threefold therapeutic system, behavioral therapy, psychotherapy and cognitive therapy. Then in the future lectures, I will explain them in detail. For the time being, these are the fundamental things that we have to learn in Buddhism regarding psychology, psychotherapy, and counseling. Thank you very much. If you have any question, you can ask now. About a short period of time we have, please raise your question.
Professor, thank you very much for your wonderful lecture. Many students from many parts of the world were very much thankful, and they were sending many thankful messages. And some students were trying to take notes, and some others were from many parts of the world. They were asking whether they can watch this video again. They want to listen to the lecture again by watching video. Then some other students were also asking for references, and already the organizers have given them the relevant internet link with which they can download the material you have prepared. So if you allow the questions, we can already the 2 hours are gone. In some countries already it is the late night. So how, Professor, do you like to have some questions now? Or?
Okay, no problem, no problem. I will give an answer to one of these questions, because some have asked about the references, no?
Yeah.
Then actually, we will tell you. We cannot give all the details in these short notes. Therefore, we have prepared the book. The book includes all the details, and later we will give information how to get it. Okay? Thank you.
So, 2 students are ready to ask questions. So, can we just allow only those 2 questions? So,
No problem. Any question? Okay.
Okay. Those who raise hand, can you kindly bring forward your question, please? One. Yeah, you can ask your question, please.
We cannot hear.
Mike is already on for everyone.
I think the mic is mute, no?
Yeah. Our professor has given time for few questions. I kindly invite our participants from many parts of the world. You can bring them on. Okay, somebody's
asking. I have one question.
Okay. Yeah, please.
In one thing, in the verbal and the visual education, sir has mentioned this thing, that virtual educations are more powerful where the audio is not much. But as per my experience, visuals having a more strong memories.
Yes, actually I missed that question, because when I mentioned about the audio through the hearing, if we develop any knowledge through the hearing, is more stronger than the visual education. That's from my idea, right? Because, you know, once we see something through our eyes, we have no question. We have seen it. You know, when we ask from someone, have you seen that? Then we say, okay, I have seen that. I know everything. But, you know, when we hear something, the mental process is going on very deeply. That we have to identify the sound first. Then we have to discern the meaning. And you know, lot of imagination, lot of thinking power should be used to identify the meaning of the hearing sound. Therefore, you know, creative ability cannot be developed by visual aids. You know, if we teach students by using visual aids, they have no creative ability. You see, in the modern world, no creators, no? Those are who, many of them are just only imitate others, that's all. They say what has been said already. But in ancient period, there were Einstein, etc., you know, many scientists, they introduced many new theories. Why? Imagination, thinking ability was increased by hearing, but not by seeing. That's what I mentioned. But anyway, as far as the methods are concerned, visual aids are very easy. But you know, we cannot develop our creative power by only using the visual aids. That's what my idea.
So, sir, is there any possibility that during the visuals and
all
during
the ancient scholars have produced many valuable and very wonderful things by hearing, not by seeing?
So, is there any possibility that during the visuals and in the audio, in our subconscious mind, it will remain, stay for a longer time?
Yes, actually, in hearing, our subconscious has to work hard, right? That means our thinking ability, actually it is a creative ability. But by seeing, there is no creation, no any creative ability that we are increasing. Because we can see everything is clear. But you know, when hearing, it is not clear, no? We have to identify the language, sound, connection between sounds and meaning, and also the subject. Then lot of thinking is going on. Therefore, people increase their creative ability by hearing than by seeing.
So we can take it as that once we go with the audio, there we get our thinking process, our analyzation become more stronger because
more stronger, we are listening yes. something. That is so my opinion. You can criticize it. Yes. No problem.
Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. That was a question from India. It was very interesting. Thank you very much for a question, and thank you very much for Professor for answer. So we can go for one more question. Yeah. Can I go to DH Ditta Dhamma? Yeah. Please. Yeah. We can't hear you. I think that mic is off. Can you? Yeah, DH Ditta Dhamma. His mic is off. Can Venerable Akhila on it?
Okay. Can you hear me? Sorry.
Okay,
sorry
about
that.
Please go on with your question.
Okay. Thank you, Professor, for the insightful explanation today. I have one question which is appear when after listening to this. In model, you say that problem solely seem to be happen because over the developed part on the simply due to lack of motion. Yet it is in this.
It is not clear. Hello, Devaran. Please say it again. It is not clear.
No, I'm just upasaka. I'm not ready.
Vibration occurs.
Can you kindly bring your question slowly with slow pronunciation?
Okay, sure. Okay, Professor, just now during your explanation, you said that I catch that the modern problem has arise due to overdevelopment of the intellect part, lack of emotion. Yeah, it is said that we've been wandering in samsara in the Tripitaka, say that it has because due to lack of panya, we don't know four noble truth. So how do you correlate? Because I think that we are so intellectual, yet all the being are not realizing that the whatever we are doing now is actually a habitual wrong habit. Can you hear me? Sorry.
සර් මේ එයා කියන්නේ මේ මේ අපි දැනට ලෝකේ මේ ප්‍රශ්න වැඩි වෙලා තියෙන්නේ ඉන්ටලෙක්ට් එක දියුණු වෙලා වැඩි ඉමෝෂනල් පැත්ත ගැන එහෙම වෙලා නැති නිසායි මේ දැනට ගැටලු ඇති වෙලා තියෙන්නේ කියලා කියනවා ඒක ගැන පැහැදිලි කිරීමක් අහන්නේ
right you know I mentioned that you know in modern educational system much attention is paid to develop the intellect, understanding, right? But human personality includes two main parts. That means emotional and intellectual. According to the modern experiments, the brain also has these two parts. The right brain is emotional. Left brain is intellectual. Therefore, you know, in order to lead a balanced life, we should develop both the sides together. But according to the modern system, what we are doing, we oppress the emotions through intellect, right? Then it is not a remedy because we let the emotional feelings to come up and time to time we oppress them by intellect. It is not the Buddhist way. According to Buddhist way, both the sides can be developed. Emotional side, when developed methodically, come to the compassion, right? Intellectual side, when developed methodically, come to the wisdom, right? Wisdom and compassion, these are the two objectives of Buddhism. Buddha has come to that level. That is why. But there in modern system of education, we don't find any particular method to develop the emotional side. To understand?
Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much for your question, Mr. Dittadam, and thank you very much for your answer, Professor. Can I next go to Mr. Sumedha Ukwatta, please? Please ask your question. I think the mic is not off. The mic is off. Can you kindly on the mic, the organizers?
Mic.
Mr. Sumedha Ukwatta is ready to ask a question. So his mic should be on by the organizers. There are two more questions. Miss Dayani Theo and Mr. Dondi Silva, their mics are also off. Okay, now, Mr. Ukwatta, your mic is on. Now you can come with your question.
Yes, thank you, Venerable Vante. So, dear Professor, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear.
Yeah, so, dear Professor, I would like to ask you that as you mentioned, Sigmund Freud mentioned that the children has stored their disposition as you explained, and we know that it is his idea. But then you mentioned in Buddhist psychology, the dispositions are in the three levels, anusaya, pariyuttana, the vitikkama. And Professor, what is your idea of, as we know that the children also have that asava and all these klesha disposition in the store in their mind as in that level. Is there any practical approach to eradicate, or is there any therapeutic way to address their issues, mental issues? I mean the young children.
Yeah, I understand your question. Now, we are dealing with many such methods in the future lectures. But for the time being, I will tell you, you know, in Buddhism, actually there is a graph also I have given. Anusaya, Pariyuttana, and Vitikkama. Right? These three levels are connected with the Sila, Samadhi, and Panya. Understand? Vitikkama is connected with Sila. Because of the behavioral pattern, once we change the behavioral pattern, we can restrain the active level, no? Then, because of the psychotherapy method, that is samadhi, through the samadhi, we can change the pariyuttana, right? And through wisdom or insight meditation, we can eliminate the latent dispositions, right? The three measures, that means sila, samadhi, panya, are applied to eliminate these three levels of problems, right? Understand?
Professor, the question was that whether children have the same things.
Yeah, yeah. Even, you know, children or elderly people, there is no difference as far as the concept of rebirth is concerned. Because even the child has passed many rebirths, thousands or millions of millions, right? Their mentality is embedded with all these latent dispositions, right? Therefore, you know, but you know that, for example, behavioral therapy means the restrainment, no? Then we can use some kind of restrainment practices with the students, right? With the young students, that, for example, in Sri Lanka, we all the children and elderly people observe the five precepts. No, when following the five precepts, actually they have a behavioral restrainment. No, and also, you know, let us say that people are as far as the psychotherapy is concerned, we can ask the little children to count the steps from this place to that place, right? You know, for example, we send them from this place to another place, and we ask them to count the steps from to that place, and when coming back, they also have to count. And also, you know, that you can write down five words and in front of them five figures. Then, you know, by closing the figures, that we can ask them to remember the word. Like that, you know, simple methods are there. In future, we will discuss them, right? That is concentration. And wisdom, you know, we have to tell them the stories, etc., right? To enlighten them. Then in the younger age, we have to use such suitable methods, right? Like that, according to the counselor's skillfulness, we can devise many plans.
Okay. Mr. Ukwatta, thank you very much for the question, and thank you very much for your answer, Professor. Then can I go to Miss Dayani Theo? Please, can you come up with your question? Can you please on her mic? Miss Dayani Theo, it's time for your question.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Bante. It was such a wonderful lecture I have ever heard, and very grateful. So earlier in your lecture, Prof, you say that thinking abilities are more by hearing than seeing. How is your comment about the researcher, the scientists who observe different stages of progress in their research? They use a lot of seeings to observe, and from that different state of their observation, they come to a conclusion, which is thinking. Thanks, Professor.
Yes, your argument is correct. That means, you know, as far as the scientific investigations are concerned, they use the microscope, etc., to see things. But, you know, it also involves the kind of the act of imagination. No? But depending on the sense data, they cannot understand anything. No? You know, the human understanding is developed because of two things: understanding the facts and understanding the relationship among the facts, causal relationship. You know, although we see things, but we have to understand their relationship by thinking. No? But actually, by hearing, they might have heard many things, right? Otherwise, they cannot develop their thinking ability. By, because you know that, for example, you study the science, no? So, by hearing your teachers, no? To your teacher. After that, you do experiments, no? Therefore, you have developed your knowledge by hearing first. Then after that, you apply your knowledge in experiments. Otherwise, without such a developed knowledge, you cannot apply the theory, no?
Thank you very much, Ms. Dayanithya, for your question, and thank you very much for your answer, Professor. Can I next go to Dondi Silva?
Thank you so much. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor, for your excellent lecture. I'm speaking to you. Part of my work consists in the UK of working voluntarily as a Buddhist chaplain, as I am called, in several universities. And sometimes I tend to struggle with the word chaplain. And your explanation about anusana is very illuminating. Now, could you please provide me with the Pali term, specific Pali term for a counselor? How would you call a counselor in Pali?
You know, as far as counseling is concerned, there are two terms that we use in Pali. One is ovada, right? The other one is anusasana. Not the counselor, counseling, I mean. Ovada and anusasana. But if we can make a noun, anusasaka and ovadaka. Ovadaka. Ovadaka and anusasaka, we can make two nouns. But however, these two actions are different. You know, ovada means giving advice, right? Anusasana means giving long discussions. Anusasana. You know, as far as younger people are concerned, young people are concerned, they should be given short advice at the time of when they are involved in some wrong actions. Only short and many times a day, right? Ovada means we should, actually ovada can be applied to young generation. Advice should be given in a short time when they are engaged in bad activities. But same advice should be given several times in the day.
So, in a nutshell, it is anusasaka.
Anusasaka means, you know, it is applied especially for the elderly people. they have many complicated problems. Therefore, we have to discuss with them at least sometimes 1 hour, 2 hours, or several days, etc.
Yes, young persons here tend to have very complicated problems.
Yeah,
even sometimes, more complicated than the elderly people.
Yeah, yeah, that also. If the problem is more complicated, we have to apply anusasana even to the young generation. No problem. But anu means in accordance with anu. Anu means in accordance with sasana means talking. Then means, you know, first of all, we have to hear. That is anu means, you know, otherwise how to advise the person in accordance with the problem. Anu means in accordance with. Therefore, first of all, we have to hear. We have to listen to the customer and then understand that in accordance with that data, we have to advise. That is anusasana.
Thank
you very much for that question, and thank you very much, Professor. Then can I go to Manju Bodh? Can you please bring your question? Mr. Manju Bodh. Mr. Manju Bodh, your mic is off. Okay.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
Vandami Banteji, and good evening, sir.
Good evening.
My question is that, sir.
Yes.
Sir told, body means material, and this material touches with the six senses, and thereafter, that the feelings comes like dislike, or it could be the neutral, or the happy or unhappy, or it could be the neutral. So in the chit, in the deep level of the chit or mind, which factor that the create this like, dislike, or neutral in the chit? Which point of the chit develop or create a feeling of like or dislike or neutral?
You know, in this case, neutral means in normal life, right? But finally, what we have to do is that you know, the third level, in the third level, we have to use the sila or moral training. In the second level, we have to use samadhi. But finally, we have to use the third level, that means wisdom, to eliminate everything completely. Till then, they are in a latent stage. The latent stage is called likes and dislikes, right? That also should be eliminated finally through wisdom.
Okay, thank you sir.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that question, and thank you, sir, for answer. Sir, thava prashna dekak thiyena kamak nenda?
Okay, amsadhipati haru kiyena nam idi prashna.
Oh, okay. Then one more. Venerable Bhikkhu Sopaka, can you come up with your question? Venerable Bhikkhu Sopaka, please come up with your question.
Yes. Thanks for your informative and invaluable lectures, Professor. I have one question. What I would like to ask to you is how should we understand the arrangement of the Nofa Ifopa? According to a hierarchical system, the most things are arranged top and down and down and top. However, in the context of the Nofa Ifopa, wisdom firstly comes, secondly, morality occurs, and then concentration arises. Therefore, how should we understand the hierarchical aura of the Nova Ipopasa? Thank you, sir.
Loba?
Nen sir, ahanne me Arya Stangika marge piliwela kohomada therum ganna one kiyala prajñāva mulakane tiyenne.
No. I explained it, you know. Samma ditthi, samma sankappa, right view and right thought should not be explained as wisdom. It is not wisdom. General understanding. You know, before we act upon something, before we follow any path, we should have a general understanding, no? That general understanding is called, because otherwise wisdom is not a we. It is Samma Ditti. Ditti is not a wisdom, no? It is understanding. But one, then we have to start with Sila. Samma Vacha Kammanta Jiva Sila. Samma Vayama Sati Samaya Samadhi. Then what happens, you know, I explain that general understanding becomes a personal experience after completing Sila and Samadhi. That it becomes a wisdom. That's what it naturally becomes. For example, suppose that you want to go from somewhere to another city. Then you first you have to understand how to go, no? Then after going there, it becomes a personal experience, no? Like that. Okay,
thank you very much, Venerable Sopaka, for your question, and thank you very much for the answer, Professor. And the last question from Venerable Vajira. Venerable Vajira, I cannot see you, but you can come up with your question. Venerable Vajira, can you come up with your question?
Yes. I'm asking, thank you for giving me a chance. Nowadays, it is very common for all human beings. Now, when we go through a lot of books, in some books, I found that this mind is two types. One is inner mind and upper mind. And someone say the upper mind is more powerful than inner mind. Someone say inner mind is more powerful than upper mind. So when we talk about this vijnana, I think mind means vijnana means wisdom or mind. A very confused one.
No.
Vijnana is mind or wisdom.
Okay, right. You know that the term vijnana, chitta, mana, and vijnana, these three terms are used in Buddhism in different contexts, in different ways. Therefore, that is why Venerable Buddha Gosa says in his Visuddhi Magga, chitta, mano, vijnana, attato, veka. All these three terms refer to the one and the same meaning. But however, remember, in different contexts, it is used in different senses. For example, you know, if it is used with the term for sense faculty, that means chakku vijnana, sota vijnana, dhana vijnana, jiva vijnana, in such context, it means awareness. Understand? Awareness. That means we become aware of the sense object. It is awareness. But you know, in the context of the five aggregates, that vijnana is the self-we or soul concept, right? It has been developed depending on sankhara, sankhara paccaya vijnana, right? Sankhara, because that consciousness depends on sankhara or concept, that we have developed our personality view depending on the concept. But there, in other contexts, chakkuncha paticca rupecha upajyati chakku vijnanam. Depending on I and the form, there arises I consciousness. It is awareness, right? That is the difference. And also, you know, vijnana is not used for wisdom. For the wisdom, we use panya, right? Sanya, vijnana, panya. These three terms have been analyzed by Venerable Buddha Gosa. Sanya is the basic knowledge, like a boy recognizes the size and color of the gems. And vijnana is like a villager realizes the color, shapes, and value of the gems. And the panya is compared to a goldsmith who understands everything about the gold. Like that, you know, three levels of understanding are indicated by sanya, vijnana, panya. These three terms. Right.
So, thank you very much, Venerable Vajira. With that, we wish to conclude the question and answer session. Please be reminded that this lecture series will have four more lectures on coming Sundays. So you can listen more to Professor and then come up with more questions in coming sessions in coming weeks on Sundays. So we should be very much thankful to senior professor, emeritus professor, our teacher, Sumanapala Galmangoda, for sparing this very valuable time. We have gone 30 minutes over the scheduled time. The professor was very kind to all of us to answer all the questions very kindly. So hereby, we conclude the session. Thank you very much for all the participants. There were hundreds of participants from many parts of the world, from Asia, from Europe, and other parts of the world. So we can see how interesting is this subject. Thank you, Professor, once again for initiating the studies for the world. It is you who initiated this, this area of discipline. You made the first syllabuses, you taught this course in the university, then you brought this subject to United Nations. On behalf of the all participants today and on behalf of the head of the department and the Department of Pali and Buddhist Studies and as your students, we are thankful very much to you and we wish you good health, long life and good night and may the noble triple gem bless you, Professor. Thank you very much. Theruvan Saravanan.